Hello everyone. Today we will talk about the mitosis and meiosis as an introduction to your course General Embryology. I'm sure that you have learned about meiosis and mitosis, and you keep wondering what are the differences between meiosis and mitosis. In the next slides, we will try to put things together to once and for all differentiate between mitosis and meiosis. According to the number of chromosomes in the nucleus of the human cells, we have two types: somatic cells and reproductive cells, also called sex cells. Now, what are the differences between these two types of cells? First of all, let's talk about the somatic cells. They have been named somatic cells as referring to the body, somatic cells. They are all the cells in your body, for example, the cells of your skin, lungs, blood cells, all the cells in your body are somatic cells, except, as you can see here, germ cells. Now, germ cells are the sperms or oocytes. Germ cells, simply, they are in the male body, they are sperms. In the female's body, they are oocytes, or any precursor cell that would become a gamete. So let's put this in its very simple definition. All the cells in your body are somatic. However, in the male, we have sperms. Only sperms are germ cells, and they are reproductive sex cells. On the other hand, in the female's body, we have oocytes representing sex cells. Therefore, let's go back and talk about the somatic cells. Now, when you look at the nucleus of the somatic cells, for example, we are talking about skin cells, epithelial cells, connective tissue cells, wherever you go in the body, fat cells. Take any cell from all these cells that I mentioned, and you would see inside its nucleus two sets of chromosomes. First set contains 23 chromosomes coming from the mother, called maternal. And the second set contains 23 chromosomes coming from the father, called paternal. Therefore, somatic cells called diploid. Diploid, it means they have two copies, two sets of chromosomes. For example, chromosome number one coming from has a copy from the mom, maternal copy, and chromosome number one coming from the dad, paternal copy. And this is true for each chromosome. So chromosome number two has as well two copies, chromosome number three, four, until we reach chromosome number 23. Now, the two chromosomes that make up each pair are called homologous chromosomes. Homologous, it means similar. We will talk about them in details later on. For now, just let's agree up on that they are almost similar. Now, what are homologous chromosomes? Homologous chromosomes, as you can see, when examined under light microscope, generally they look very similar. The exception to this rule is one pair of chromosomes called sex chromosomes, X and Y. In females, the homologous pair of sex chromosomes consists of two large X chromosomes. In males, the pair consists of an X and a much smaller Y chromosome. Now, I'll take you to the next slide. Then I will go back to that to talk about the definition of homologous chromosomes. Now, from the beginning, we talked about two types of cells. The common one is the somatic. It's everywhere in your body, represents all the cells in your body, except the second type, which is sex cells. We will talk about them later on. Now, let's go back to the somatic cells. If you open up the nucleus of any somatic cell, you would see this picture, specially prepared. You can't see it straight away. You have to put it in certain test to get this picture that we are looking at now. But for teaching purposes, this is a perfect picture. As you can see, this is chromosome number one, and this is chromosome number one as well. So this is the first pair of your chromosomes. One of them usually comes from your mom, maternal, and the other one comes from your dad, paternal. Are they different? Generally speaking, they are not different. But when you go in details, they are having some differences. We will not focus on these differences today. Now, how we know that this is chromosome number one? Chromosome number one is said to be the longest one, and two is shorter than number one. And there you go, the third is shorter until we reach the end of these chromosomes. So we classify them according to their length, of course. So as you can see, in somatic cells, we have two copies. This is very important to understand. A copy from your dad and a copy from your mom. Paternal copy and maternal copy for the same exactly chromosome. Now, we name these two homologous chromosomes, and let's go back to this. This is paternal, and this is maternal. Now, as I mentioned just seconds ago, for each chromosome, we have two copies. When we have two copies, we name these cells as diploid cells. For example, epithelial cells, are they diploid? Yes, they are. Why? Simply because they have 23 copies coming from mom, maternal, and 23 copies coming from their dad, paternal copies. For each chromosome, we have two copies. When we get that, then the cell should be named diploid cell. Somatic, diploid, and we use the symbol 2N. 2N, it means that we in the cell, in the nucleus of the cell, we have copies, two copies for each chromosome. Now, homologous, it means similar. If you look at chromosome number one, they are almost identical. Go to number two, three, four, 24 until you reach 22. They are almost identical. When it comes to chromosome number 23, if we are talking about a male, then we will the chromosome number 23, they will not be identical. We will have a large X chromosome and small Y chromosome. Only in this type we have different last pair of chromosomes named sex chromosomes, and this is exactly what has been written here. So the exception to this rule, which rule? That all chromosomes are homologous, as you can see, identical to each other. This is true from 1 to 22. However, if we are talking about a male, then the chromosome 23, sex chromosomes are different. In females, however, the homologous pair of sex chromosomes consist of two large X. So had this been for a female, you would have seen here instead of Y, you would have seen also similar to this one, X standing here. And in females, everything goes in organization, even for their chromosomes. They are identical from number 1 to reach number 23. Now, where can we find somatic cells? I did mention that they are everywhere in your body. In fact, all the cells in your body are somatic, except those in the reproductive areas, the ovaries and the testes. Apart from that, they are all somatic cells. Now, the most important question is how they divide somatic cells. Now, before we answer this question, I'd like you to think, why do we need somatic cells to divide? The answer should be either to replace lost cells during everyday activities, or for growth. So in both cases, I'm assuming that we are looking for the same cells. So if you lost skin cells, you need to replace them by skin cells. You've lost epithelial cells, you need to replace them by epithelial cells. You've lost connective tissue cells, you need to replace it by connective tissue cells. This is important. So we do need the exact copy of the cell, and therefore we would use this type of division, mitosis. Mitosis should be defined as the kind of division that preserves everything. If you need copies of the same cell, then you need to use mitosis. Why? Mitosis usually gives off two daughter cells, as you can see in this example, that they are similar to the original cell. 46 chromosomes, we did mention that. This is an example of a somatic cell. 23 chromosomes here coming from your mom, and 23 chromosomes coming from your dad. Paternal copy for each chromosome, maternal copy for each chromosome. Put everything together, they should be 46 chromosomes, or 23 pairs of chromosomes. Now, you need mitosis to give you two cells, but they have to preserve the same amount of chromosomes, and that's exactly what mitosis does. Now, quickly, let's talk about reproductive cells. Of course, somatic cells will stay with us. We will talk about them shortly. However, your course of embryology is focusing on the reproductive cells. Reproductive cells, as you can see here, they are also called sex cells. Where can we find them? Only in gonads. Gonads, it means the reproductive areas in males named testes, and reproductive organs in females, namely the ovaries. Only there you can find sex cells. Therefore, they are very limited. They contain only 23 chromosomes. That is why they are called haploid cells. So we did mention somatic cells. They have a copy from your mom, a copy from your dad for each chromosome. And therefore, we named them diploid, double of the chromosomes, two copies. Here, totally the opposite. We have from each chromosome only one single copy. Therefore, sperm or an oocyte, they have only 23 chromosomes. They don't have two copies. We will talk about this just in a moment. And that's why we call them 1N haploid. Now, how they divide these cells? Now, before we answer this question, I'd like to ask you why they should divide. To maintain life? To maintain what? To replace injured cells? No, at all. These cells are of special function. Their function is reproduction. So they are dividing for a purpose to increase the number of the cells and to do something else totally different from the mitosis. These cells are dividing not to replace lost cells. These cells are not dividing for the sake of growth. They are dividing to maintain the number of cells and for different purposes. And that's why they'll use meiosis. Meiosis is a very unique type of division. It's totally different from mitosis. So let me remind you about this. Sex cells, they are limited. They are only, you can find them in certain areas in your body. And their idea of division is totally different. It's not to replace lost cells. It's to maintain the number of cells. And they use meiosis. And therefore, now I'll compare between meiosis and mitosis, and you would come to the conclusion that they are totally different from each other, meiosis and mitosis. In this example, as you can see, a reproductive cell in the ovary or in the testes, but you need to understand that all germ cells that are oocytes or the sperms, originally before they mature into sperm or an oocyte, they were somatic cells. So this is very important, and at the same time it is confusing. In the ovaries, the whole process begins from somatic cell. Then out of this somatic cell, we're gonna get germ cells. In the case of the ovaries, we're gonna get oocytes. In the case of the testes, we're gonna get sperms. So this example, as you can see, assuming that in the ovary the whole story begins from 46 to N. So in this cell we have a copy from chromosome number 1, a copy for chromosome number 1 from mom, maternal, a copy from chromosome number 1, paternal. And exactly for the chromosome number 2, 3, until we reach number 23. That's why it's 2N. Now, if you use mitosis for this cell to divide, you would get exactly the same number, 46, 2N, two cells with the exact number of chromosomes as in original cells. However, we did mention that for sex cells, we do need meiosis. Meiosis does not preserve the number of chromosomes. Instead, it splits the number of chromosomes into half. As you can see, the daughter cells, they are having only one copy of each chromosome. So we split homologous chromosomes. We put one copy from each chromosome in one cell, and now we have 23 chromosomes, we name it 1N, in each cell. So meiosis does not conserve chromosomes number, instead it reduces it by half. This is the way we increase the number of the cells and making them suitable to for the sperm, for example, to fertilize the egg. Now, that was a brief description describing meiosis and mitosis. Now, let's talk about cell division in general. For any cell to divide, before division, you need each cell needs to go through a unique process, a process named replication, duplication of chromosomes, and duplication of other structures in the cell. What I'm saying here is simply to understand that you can't divide a cell without replicating its contents. You need to replicate everything inside the cell, then you divide it. Whether you divide it by meiosis or mitosis, it depends upon the type of the cell that you are choosing. If we are talking about divisions in the oocyte, in the ovaries, then we would use meiosis. If we are talking about division in the body cells, somatic cells, then we use mitosis. But you have to understand, in both types, meiosis or mitosis, cells, they have to go through replication. And that's why the cell cycle consists of two major periods, interphase or mitotic phase. Cell either preparing for division or it divides. Interphase, look at this phase, interphase. It's a long phase that within this phase we prepare the cell for division. Let's talk about the interphase. The interphase is a state of high metabolic activity. It is during this time that the cell does most of its growing. During interphase, the cell replicates its DNA. We would come to this just in a moment. Produces additional organelles. Of course, if you need two cells out of one cell, you need to duplicate not only the DNA, but also small organelles inside the cytosolic component. The interphase itself has three phases. G G1, S, and G2. Now, G1 phase and G2, I will talk about them shortly, but let's talk about the most important phase in the interphase, which is all about DNA synthesis, and it is named S phase, and the S stands for synthesis. It's in this phase that we replicate the DNA. Now, if we take the nucleus, inside it there is a chromatin juice. This chromatin juice, if we go and look at it carefully, you would see that it is made out of chromosomes. Now, if we take part of this chromosome, loop of this chromosome, and take it and make it larger, you would see that a chromatin fiber is made out of nothing but a nucleosome. A nucleosome is, when you go and make it bigger, it is nothing but DNA. So that's why it's very important to us to understand that if you need to make out of one cell two daughter cells, you need to preserve the genetic material. It's all about the genetic material. So the genetic material is conserved preserved inside the nucleus in a form of chromosomes. So when we go and look at chromosomes, we are talking about nothing but DNA. So what is the chromosome structure? It's DNA helix, protein called histones. They wrapping themselves around the histones, DNA, and what we got now is nucleosome. Called nucleosomes, they make looped chromatin. Now each chromatin condensed, and they form chromosomes. So chromosomes are nothing but DNA. So for you to get a similar cell out of any cell, you need to duplicate your DNA. Once the DNA has been duplicated, it means each chromosome has been duplicated. So from chromosome number one, we already having a double chromosome number one. I'm talking about chromosome number one, for example, paternal copy. After the duplication of DNA, after S phase, we would have inside the nucleus for chromosome number one a sister chromatid, a copy for this chromosome, sister chromatid. And we did mention from the beginning that each chromosome in the somatic cells has its copy. So we have also for chromosome number one a copy, maternal copy, and we named them homologous. Now the maternal copy also would do the same thing, and it would duplicate its DNA, resulting in duplicating its chromosome. So what we have before the division kicks off, before that we have for each chromosome its sister chromatid. So at the end, that was, for example, chromosome number one in the cell, paternal copy. Now it has its sister chromatid. Now for its homologous maternal copy, also the same would take place. So during interphase, especially during S phase, each double helix of DNA would split and attract another chemicals, and it would make another DNA. This DNA would coil around histones, and it would make nucleosomes, and nucleosomes will condense into individual chromosomes. So what we have now, that was the original story for that was chromosome, for example, number one, paternal copy, now it has been duplicated. This, we name them sister chromatids. So sister chromatids are totally different from homologous chromatids, and we need maybe to understand this. Here, this is these are chromosomes before they're going into interphase. What we have here, as I mentioned earlier, a copy from chromosome number one coming from your mom, maternal, from your dad, paternal. These are homologous chromosomes. Now, when the cell is preparing itself for division, it goes into interphase. Inside this interphase, there is a very important process named S phase. During S phase, we replicate our DNA. So each chromosome here would have its own sister chromatid. It would have its own sister chromatid, as you can see here. So this is very important to understand the rest of this lecture. These two were originally there in the cell. We named them homologous chromosomes. A copy from your mom, a copy from your dad. Now, each one of them has replicated, and as a result, we having here sister chromatids. So the yellow one is replicate of this one. We then call them sister chromatids. We call them sister chromatids. So we're going back to the cell division. I told you any cell before it goes either meiosis or mitosis, it has to duplicate and replicate its organelles and especially DNA in a process we call it interphase, divided into S phase concerned with DNA. It's very important to preserve genetic material. If you need a skin cell, then you need to get its DNA. So the outcome would be skin cell. So it's all about DNA replication, and this is a very crucial step in division. And two G phases. G stands for gap. It means because of the importance of S phase, we referring to it as if the cell is engaged while it is making, duplicating DNA. If it's not doing this, if it's not replicating DNA, if it's not duplicating its DNA, then the cell is said to be in a gap. During this gap, we have two gaps, G1 and G2, as you can see in this, I think, here. G phases, they are concerned about organelles. The cell replicates most of its organelles, and cytosolic components, but not its DNA, and this is obvious. G2 is the interval between S phase and the mitotic phase. It is before the cell division. It lasts 4 to 6 hours. Cell growth continues. Enzymes and other proteins are synthesized in preparation for cell division. Replication of centrosomes is completed. So as you can see, interphase, it's all about S phase, where the most important material should replicate itself. It's the DNA. as a result of this phase, S phase, we're gonna get out of each chromosome its sister chromatid. So the number would increase. Instead of 23 maternal, we would have 46. And instead of 23 paternal, we would have 46. So before the cell divides, in fact, we have 92 chromosomes, but we can't see them because they would because they look like a chromatin juice. Once the cell entered division, we can talk about them in a prophase stage. Now, although this is maybe not important for our course, but it's written here that some cells, they don't replicate and they don't divide. A very common type of these cells are our nerve cells. They go into G1, and the duration of this phase is quite variable. It is very short in many embryonic cells or cancer cells. Cells that remain in G1, what I was talking about, for a very long time, perhaps distant nerve to divide again. So they just go into phase one and they don't complete it. Don't focus on this. I'm not interested in this course. It's not designed to talk about the molecular processes before division. I would rather you to focus on the names. You need to know what's going inside during G1 and during G2, and why we name them G1 and G2, and what's going during these two phases. But the most important thing for me is this phase where the DNA replicates itself, which result and which leads to sister chromatid. We did explain this. I hope you did understand that. Now, that was interphase where we prepare the cell for division. Now, this is the moment of truth. If you are designing cells to replace or for growth, then, and you are talking about somatic cells, then you go through mitosis, which is the most common type of division in your body. Now, if we are talking about cells inside ovaries or testes, then we will divide using meiosis, not mitosis. For each cell division, whether it is meiosis and mitosis, whether it is meiosis or mitosis, you have to understand that both they are running in the same almost phases, either interphase or meiotic phase. We are talking about this phase. They are consisting of prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. Well, this is exactly for meiosis and mitosis. So we will talk about each one in details later on.